Aren't you glad for the goodness of God? Amen. What a good God we serve. Thank you. You may be seated. Welcome. It's great to have all of you worshiping with us today. And as we always do this time in the morning, we just welcome in all of our family that's spread out all over the place. Of course, we have those that are right here in the Gospel Center at our Gaylor campus. We have those that are watching right now here at the Gaylor campus, but down in the chapel. They're part of our classic service down there. If you didn't know it, every Sunday morning at 9 o'clock, we have another service takes place down there with some of the old hymns and choruses. And on the fourth Sunday of every month, my wife and I, we lead the worship down there. It's a wonderful service down there. We welcome them. Of course, our Sault Ste. Marie campus, so good to have you worshiping with us today. Thank you for joining us, our online campus from all over. Those who are watching this morning on Folks Listen TV, received many emails this morning from our viewers. And those who are listening on the Eagle 101.5 FM, they have been broadcasting this 9 o'clock service live for nearly 10 years. And when they first came to me nearly 10 years ago and asked me about it, I said, well, our service goes longer than an hour. It's all because the worship goes over. The preaching's always on time. But it goes longer than an hour. And they said, that's no problem. We'll air the whole thing, and we'll just fill in the rest of the half hour on the flip side. And they fill it in every Sunday with the Mormon Tabernacle Choir. And people think it's us. It's amazing. But nonetheless, it's great to have you listening on the Eagle as well. And you know what? Obviously, this year, Veterans Day fell kind of in between Sundays. But could we do this no matter where you are, the Gaylor campus, the Classic Service, the Sioux campus? And if you're watching online, would you please just note maybe the branch you served in the comment section? If you're a veteran, would you stand so we can honor you this morning? All of our veterans, God bless you. Thank you. Thank you so much for all of your service, your sacrifice. Praise the Lord. Again, if you're watching online, make sure you make a comment there. But we didn't want to miss that, even though it kind of fell in between Sundays. Hey, listen, next Sunday obviously is a big Sunday. It's in-gathering Sunday here at E-Free Church, the Sunday before Thanksgiving. It's going to be a really, really special morning. At both of our campuses, of course, with worship and preaching, we'll be dedicating our Operation Christmas Child shoeboxes. If you haven't done yours yet, you still got 1 week, pick up a box on your way out. They're located in the foyer here at the Gaylor campus. And bring them back next week. Make sure you bring them all back next week. We'll have them all lined up front, and we will take time to dedicate those boxes before they're sent to children all over the world. So that's always an exciting time as well. And at both of our campuses, all morning long, there'll be food stations. We don't have the big dinner after the second service this year like we've done in the past, but instead all morning long. So doesn't matter what service you come to, there'll be food stations all throughout the lobby. They're free. Enjoy what's there. Get to know each other. And also next Sunday, all the drinks, even the specialty drinks at the cafe, will all be free. So make sure you enjoy those as well. That'll take place at both of our campuses. Now, here at our Gaylor campus, we're also going to be having a baptism. And we have a lot of people scheduled to be baptized. Most of them, I think, the 10:30 service. But a lot of people getting baptized. We're going to be welcoming more than 20 new members into our church next Sunday. And we have a child dedication all taking place next Sunday. So it's not too late to get on that either. Call the church office this week if you'd like to dedicate your child or children to the Lord. All that will take place next Sunday, very, very special day. And that's why, for those of you who are watching online, we really encourage you to come. Plan a road trip. If you live within 2 to 3 hours, get up a little early. Come and join us either the 9 or 10:30 service. If you're a little bit more distance than that, why don't you come up the night before? And in fact, I got word this week that Treetops Golf Resort is going to give a special rate to any of our online viewers that want to come up the night before. You can get a room there for $79. That's amazing. When you call, make the reservation, just mention E-Free Church. And if you need the phone number, anything like that, just ask in the comments section or call the church office. We'll get you that info. And here at our Gaylor campus, anyone that comes from the online campus, we'll have a special place designated. We'd love for you to drop by there, introduce yourselves. You'll meet some of our online hosts. I'll be over there as well to meet you. So it's going to be a fun, fun morning. Of course, next Sunday is also our in-gathering project offering. We've been talking about that a lot. And this year's project is to raise much of the seed money that's needed to start what will be our fourth campus of E-Free Church here in Northern Michigan. We have the Gaylor campus, we have the Sault Ste. Marie campus, we have our online campus, and now we're looking to start a third physical campus, which will be our fourth campus in total. Now, our plan is this. Next year, 2022, we want to identify the exact location and put the strategy together. And then in 2023, we're looking to hire the point person for that campus a year early so they can do all of the pre-launch work, as well as learning our DNA, learning our culture. Then in 2024, we'll do a big promotional blitz in that area that leads into the launch of our next campus. And so we've set up a three-tier goal for this project. Goal number one, tier one, is $75,000. And if God allowed us to bring in $75,000 in that offering, we would be able to hire that point person a year early, as well as have the money needed for the pre-launch work. Goal number two, tier number two, is $150,000. That would allow us to do everything in tier number one, plus purchase some of the needed equipment for a video venue. Remember, our campuses, while there's a live campus pastor, live worship, live children's ministry, the sermons are a video feed. So we're all hearing the same sermon the same day. And obviously that takes some equipment to do that. And then if God by his grace allows us to reach our top goal of $200,000, we could do all of that plus have the money necessary to do that pre-launch promotional blitz in that area. So I hope you'll be praying about that this week. I hope you're already praying about your best gift over and above your regular giving. You should have received in the mail this past week a letter explaining it, along with an in-gathering envelope that you can use. You don't have to use it, but you can. And the way the giving will work next week at all of our campuses, you'll give your regular offering like normal, whether you do it online, which is what majority of people do now, or whether you put it in the giving boxes in the back of the auditorium. But next Sunday, later in the service at all of our campuses, we will actually pass the offering plate, something we haven't done in a long, long time. In fact, I think the last time we did it may have been last year's in-gathering. And anything that goes into that offering, that's what goes to the in-gathering project. Again, you can use the envelope you got in the mail. You don't have to. If it goes in that offering, it'll go towards it. And also, you can give online. Miefree.org, miefree.org. Click on give and then mark your gift in gathering fund. Or you can mail a check to the church, but make sure you put on the memo line in gathering so we know where it's designated to. So all of that is taking place next Sunday. Now also, along with that, next Sunday begins our virtual annual congregational meeting, business meeting. And we have to, as a congregation, we need to approve a couple things. One is our 2022 budget. And the other one is we have two elders who are being reelected. Our church votes on all of our elders. They serve three-year terms as that leadership board of our church. We have two of them, Daryl DeSluver and Matt Smith, who this December will complete their 3 years but are willing to serve another 3 years. They're wonderful men, and so the congregation needs to approve that. So here's what's going to happen. You're going to receive an email with a link. You go to that link, and there's a short 12, 13-minute video where I interview our church chairman, Ed Hunt, Jim Kaiser, and our elder chairman, Ed Hunt, along with our church administrator, Brian Swatulski. They give you all the information you need to know, and then there's another link you can use to have an online ballot. Now, you must be a member to vote, okay? We'd love to have everybody watch the video, but you must be a member to vote. Now, maybe you like voting the old-fashioned way. That's okay, because on November 28th and December 5th, there'll be a table in the foyer at both campuses with paper ballots that you can use as well. There'll also at that table be an elder and a representative from the leadership team. If you have any questions, you can ask them. If you're at our Sioux campus, you have any questions, just go through Pastor Steve. We'll get those answered for you. And you can vote anytime between November 21st and December 5th. Again, the paper ballots will be available November 28th and December 5th. All of that was explained in the letter you received this week as well. So a lot of stuff going on. And as soon as December 21st is over, we start our Christmas series. That'll begin November 28th. We're calling this year's series An Epic Christmas. And that'll start November the 28th and lead us right up to Christmas Eve. Well, this morning, we want to take time now to wrap up a series we've been doing. This is week number 4 through Deuteronomy chapter 6, a series we're calling Legacy. And together we're learning the importance of and how to pass our faith down to our children and our grandchildren. We've spent a lot of time each week talking about the key verse in this chapter, verse 4 and verse 5, which tells us these words, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, and all your might." And then beginning in verse 6, we learn how to pass that on to our kids and our grandkids. And we saw last Sunday that that includes, number 1, we need to pass our faith along through our example. Deuteronomy 6:6 said that these words should be on our heart. It's how we live. It's who we are. Folks, you cannot pass on what you do not possess. So first, we teach our children faith through our example. But then we saw in verses 7 through 9, we also teach them faith through our education, through what we teach them, what we say to them. And we saw 3 things that were important there. We saw, number 1, that involves being diligent, because we're to teach them diligently, a word that means repeatedly. We also saw that along with being diligent, it needs to be consistent. We're to do it in all activities, at all times, in all locations. It should be part of our life. Part of the DNA and culture of your family is you talk about God. You talk about the Bible. And then we also saw that it needs to be evident. In other words, we need to use visual ways to teach our children, creative ways to teach our children. And we talked all about that last Sunday. Now, what we want to do today is to finish the chapter. And we took 3 Sundays to cover the first 9 verses. Now, today, we're going to cover verse 10 through 25 in one setting, so we're going to move a little bit quickly. I want to begin, though, by reading Deuteronomy 6, verses 10 and 11, and I want to invite you at all of our campuses, no matter where you're watching from, if you're able, would you stand with me in honor of the Word of God as I read Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 10 and verse 11. And here's what Scripture says. Moses says to the children of Israel who are about to cross the Jordan and enter the promised land, it says, "Then it shall come about when the Lord your God brings you into the land which he swore to your fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, to give you great and splendid cities." And here comes the key phrase, "which you did not build, and houses full of good things," and here's a key phrase, "which you did not fill, and hewn cisterns, wells," and here's a key phrase, "which you did not dig, vineyards and olive trees," key phrase, "which you did not plant." But even though you didn't build it, you didn't fill it, you didn't dig it, you didn't plant it, you will eat and you will be satisfied. And may God bless the reading of his word. Thank you. You may be seated. Now, notice three things here. Notice three things. That Moses wants to make sure the parents and grandparents, because that's who this chapter is written to, realize. Because these become the motivational factor for why we should pass our faith to our children and our grandchildren. And he says, first of all, notice the certainty of it. He reminds them that God is going to keep his promise. And they will enter the promised land. Now, this has been a promise that goes all the way back to Abraham. Hundreds of years. It went from Abraham to Isaac to Jacob. Ultimately, it came down to this generation's parents and grandparents, but they didn't believe the promise. They didn't obey God. They didn't see the promise fulfilled. But the generation of parents and grandparents that Moses writes to will. He says, God's made you a promise. There's a certainty to this. You will enter the promised land. And then he gives some characteristics of that. He talks about the fact that there'll be many blessings in this land. There'll be cities in the land. There'll be houses full of things in the land. There'll be wells where they can get water. There'll be olive trees and vineyards where they can eat from. But he reminds them at every step of the way that all of those blessings are not because they did anything. They didn't build the cities. They didn't fill the houses. They didn't dig the wells. They didn't plant the olive trees. They didn't plant and prune the vineyards. But yet they will enjoy all of the fruit of it. And then he says, here's the conclusion. As you enjoy it, you will be satisfied. Now, I want you to pass your faith along to your children and along to your grandchildren as you enter this land, as you experience these blessings, as you are satisfied, make sure you pass your faith along. Now, it's interesting because the truth of the matter is there's a parallel between what Moses was describing for Israel and what's true of you and I as the church today. You see, there's a certainty involved for you and I. Because God has promised us a quote-unquote promised land. But for us, that land is heaven. And God has promised that those who have put their faith in Jesus receive the free gift of eternal life in heaven. Jesus was the first one to promise it in John 14 when he said, in my Father's house are many dwelling places. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself that where I am, there you may be also. He made a promise. He's promised those of us who have put our faith in Jesus an eternal home, an eternal promised land called heaven. There's a certainty. And there's also some similar characteristics. In this, there'll be all kinds of blessings there. But those blessings will not be there because we did anything. There will be jeweled walls in heaven. We didn't make the walls. There'll be gates made of pearls. We didn't make the gates. There'll be all these dwelling places. We didn't make them. There'll be a street of pure gold. We didn't pave it. There'll be a tree of life. We didn't plant it. But even though we didn't do any of that, we will experience the blessing. And the result, the conclusion, will be this. We will be satisfied. I'm often, almost weekly, asked questions that kind of go this way. Will blank be in heaven? Or will we do blank in heaven? I'm asked that all the time. Will my pet be in heaven? I'm asked it all the time. By the way, don't ask me that because you may not like my answer. But we're asked those questions all the time. And here's what I would say to every one of them. My answer is, it really doesn't matter. You know why? Because you will not ever in heaven think this, I wish. You'll never think that. There won't be anything you miss that's not there. You will be completely satisfied. So there is a correlation between what Moses is teaching Israel and us. And that's why, folks, you and I must take seriously the need to pass our faith down to our children and our grandchildren. Well, we're going to wrap it up now in verses 10 through 25. We're going to look now at the actions of a parent and the answers of a parent. Let me start by reading verse 12, Deuteronomy 6, verse 12. He says, since all this is true, parents, grandparents, watch yourself, be careful that you do not forget the Lord who brought you from the land of Egypt out of the house of slavery. So notice some of the actions that he reminds parents and grandparents that are needed to be in place if you're going to pass your faith down to your children and grandchildren. And one of them is this: there is a need for remembrance. There is a need for you to remember. Now, what are you supposed to remember? Number one, remember who your God is. Now that goes all the way back to verse number 4. Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord is one. He's not just a personal God, he is the only God. And now Moses reminds parents and grandparents, don't forget that fact. And why was that crucial? Because in the land they were about to go into, the Canaanite people that filled that land had multiple gods, more than you can imagine. Hundreds of gods were worshipped in this land. And the temptation for Israel would be to begin to add some of those gods to the God they serve. And so God is saying to them, as you enter the land, it is vitally important that you remember that not only is God your God, he is the only God. So do not forget who your God is. And then secondly, do not forget what he has done. And he reminds them of how God brought Israel out of slavery in Egypt. Don't forget what he's done. No other false God can do for you what the true God has already done for you. That's what he's saying. It's amazing, especially through the Old Testament, how many times you see that command. Do not forget what God has done. Do you know why you see it so often? Because we are forgetful people. We are. And that's why I encourage believers to take time to keep a spiritual journal of sorts, where 2, maybe 3 times a week, you just take a couple minutes and you write down what God has done in your life. And you will be amazed a year from now when you go back and read those journals. You go, I totally forgot that God did that. Do not forget who your God is. Do not forget what he has done. There is a need for remembrance. Look at verse 13. You shall fear only the Lord your God. Please make sure you see that word. He did not say you shall fear the Lord your God. He said you shall fear only, exclusively the Lord your God. And you shall worship, and you could put that word in again, only him, exclusively him. And you will swear, and you could put in the word only, exclusively by his name. So not only is there a need in my life as a parent and a grandparent for remembrance if I'm going to pass my faith to my children and grandchildren, but there's also a need for reverence. A need for reverence. And in the passage, we learn that we are to fear only God. Now, we've talked about what it means to fear God. Fearing God means you take him seriously. That's what it means. So if God says it and I fear him, I take him seriously, what will I do? I'll do it. If God says not to do it and I fear him, I take him seriously, I won't do it. If God says it and I fear him, I take him seriously, I'll believe it. If God promises it and I fear him, I take him seriously, I will claim it. And so we are told in this passage, he's saying, when you go into the promised land, you need to fear only your God. In a land that's going to be filled with many gods, you fear only your God. And not only that, you are to worship who? Only your God. In a land that is filled with many, many gods, you worship only your God. When you go into this land, you will be around people who worship multiple gods, but you worship only your God. Do not divide your allegiance. And then he says, swear only by his name. Now, we don't have time to really look into the biblical concept of what that means, but let me tell you this. It's not simply, I say, an oath, you know, so help me God. That's not what this verse is teaching, all right? Some people feel like I can never say those words because that's swearing. No, that's not what it means. To swear by someone greater than you in the Bible really was a sign of dedication. So really, here's what he's saying. Be dedicated only to your God. You are to fear only your God. You are to worship only your God, and you are to be dedicated to only your God. Now, why is this important? Here's why. We've said it every week in the series. Because your children will not remember most of what you tell them, but they will remember how they see you live. They'll remember that. When you die and your children talk about you, they're not going to talk about the things you said. They're going to talk about the way you lived. There's the need for remembrance. There's the need for reverence. Look at verses 14 through 16. Let me show you another one. You shall not follow any other gods. Any of the gods of the peoples who surround you, and there'll be lots of them. For the Lord your God in the midst of you is a jealous God. Otherwise, the anger of the Lord will be kindled against you, and he'll wipe you off the face of the earth. You shall not put the Lord your God to the test as you tested him at Massah. So not only is there a need for remembrance, not only is there a need for reverence, there's a need for resolve. Do not follow other gods. Do not put the Lord your God to the test. How do you put the Lord your God to the test? When you follow other gods. By the way, this phrase in Deuteronomy 6 was quoted by Jesus himself. In Matthew chapter 5, Satan tempts Jesus three different times. And that one temptation takes place beginning in verse number 5 of Matthew 5. Let me read it. Then the devil took Jesus into the holy city, that's Jerusalem, and had him stand on the pinnacle of the temple, the highest point, and said to him, here's what Satan says to Jesus. If you are the Son of God, prove it. Throw yourself down, jump off the pinnacle. For it is written, and Satan quotes scripture. Now, wait, before I read it, think about that. How does Satan try to tempt Jesus? By quoting scripture. He takes scripture out of context. By the way, that is still one of Satan's chief ploys today. He will mess up many followers of Jesus who will hear somebody say something using a scripture verse, but the problem is they've taken that verse out of context and it doesn't mean anything close to what they're saying it means. Be careful. Just because someone quotes scripture doesn't mean they're teaching truth. Be careful. Here's what Satan says. For it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and on the hands they will bear you up, so that you will not strike your foot against a stone. And Jesus said to him, oh yeah? You got to know the Greek to see that. It's written also this, you shall not put the Lord your God to the test. And he quotes directly from this passage. Now Moses in this passage gives a human example of what the parents and grandparents that he's writing to, what their parents and grandparents did 40 years earlier. And 40 years earlier, they tested God at a place called Massa, when in spite of God's goodness, they got impatient due to a lack of water, and they questioned if God was even among them. They began to conclude maybe God isn't a good God. They began to conclude maybe God isn't real. They began to conclude maybe some of these other gods make more sense. They put God to the test. Exodus chapter 17, verse 7 says, he named the place Massa and Meribah because of the quarrel of the sons of Israel, because they tested the Lord, saying, is the Lord really among us or not? You see, we test God whenever we decide it's time to look to other gods in our life. There's the need for remembrance. There's the need for reverence. There's the need for resolve. Now let me read verses 17 through 19. You should diligently keep the commandments of the Lord your God and his testimonies and his statutes which he commanded you. Verse 18. You shall do what is right and good in the sight of the Lord. And don't miss the next phrase. Why? Why does God give us commands? Why does God give us restrictions? Why does God give us guidelines to live by? Here's the reason. So that it may be well with you. Ladies and gentlemen, you will never experience God's best for your life without obeying his commands. You will never experience God's best without obeying God's commands. That you may go in and possess the good land which the Lord swore to you, driving out all the enemies. So not only is there a need for remembrance, not only is there a need for a reverence, not only is there a need for resolve, there's also a need for righteousness. You should keep the commandments of the Lord. You shall do what is right. Here's what he's saying. If you're going to pass your faith down to your children and grandchildren, they must see that you have made God first place in your life. They must see your commitment to obey him. They must see your commitment to honor him. They must see your commitment to worship him. He must be first place in your life. You see, when you go back to the generation of parents and grandparents before this group, one of their biggest problems was this. They literally put their children ahead of God. God promised them the land. God said, now go in, possess it. I'll give it to you. Remember what they did? They sent in spies. And the spies came back and said, there are giants in the land. And in Deuteronomy chapter 1, verse 39, you know what we read? We read that those parents said, then we're not going in that land. That won't be the best thing for our kids. It's exactly what they said. We're not going to go in that land because it could hurt our kids. We're not going to obey God because we don't think that's the best thing for our kids. And you know what happened as a result? Not only did those parents never enter the land, but because of their sin, their children were not able to grow up in the land. God must be first place. And sometimes we get that a little confused. Well, I need to put my children first. No, ladies and gentlemen, listen, the best thing you can do for your children is to put God first. That's the best thing you can do for your children. And a wife might say, but I want my husband to see me as his priority. No, you don't. No, you don't. You want your husband to see Jesus as his first priority. Before we can ever pass our faith down to our children and grandchildren, God must be first in our life. And with the actions of a parent, we now see the answers of a parent. And I love this. Because Moses says, as you do this with your children, as you teach them the commandments, as you model it, as you teach them through your example, through your education, as you do all of this, they're going to ask you questions. There's going to be an inquiry. Look at verse 20. When, not if, when your son asks you in time to come, Dad, what do the testimonies and statutes and judgments mean? Why are we obeying these anyway? That's going to happen. Your children are going to ask you questions. Dad, why do we have to go to church? None of my friends go to church. Mom, why can't we do that? Our friends get to do it. And when they're little, they'll ask because they're inquisitive. When they reach teenage years, they'll ask because they're investigating. And that's not a bad thing. There will come a point when your teenager will begin to question things like, how do I know God really exists? How do I know the Bible's really true? And some parents, when teenagers begin to question that, they freak out. Oh no, my kid's an apostate. They just freak out. It's not a bad thing. You know why? Because the greatest thing that can happen to your child is that they move from it's my parents' faith to it's my faith. It's my faith. And sometimes they have to ask those questions to get there. There will be an inquiry. And I love the instruction that Moses gives the parents. He says this. When that happens, when they ask you these questions, here's what you tell them. Number one, here is what God did. That's the first thing you share with them. Son, let me tell you what God did. Let me tell you what God did. Look at verse number 21. Then you shall say to your son when they ask you, let me tell you what God did. We were slaves to Pharaoh in Egypt, and the Lord brought us from Egypt with a mighty hand. Verse 22. Moreover, the Lord showed great and distressing signs and wonders before our eyes against Egypt, Pharaoh, and all his household. He brought us out from there in order to bring us in, to give us this land. In other words, son, he's a good God. Let me tell you what he's done for us. That's why I love him. That's why I serve him. That's why I obey him. And moms and dads and grandmas and grandpas, it's not enough for you to tell your children and grandchildren what God did for Moses and what God did for Noah and what God did for David and Paul and Peter and John. They need to hear what God has done for you. They need to hear how God's been faithful to you. They need to hear how God brought you through some trials. They need to hear how he answered your prayers. They need to hear how he blessed you and provided for you when you stayed faithful to obeying him. Tell them what God has done. He's a faithful God. So number one, tell them what God did. Number two, tell them what God said. And here's what this faithful God said, Deuteronomy 6:24. So the Lord commanded us to observe all these statutes, to fear the Lord our God. And why did he tell us to do it? For our good. That's why we do it. Son, that's why we do it. We do it because this is the best thing for us and for our survival. So you tell him what God did. You tell him what God said. And I love the last one. And you tell him what God has promised. Verse 25. It will be righteousness for us if we're careful to observe the commandments before the Lord our God, just as he commanded us. And son, you know why else we do it? Because God has promised his blessing when we obey him. God has promised that we will live life to its fullest when we obey him. So, son, here's what God did. Here's what God said. Here's what God has promised. Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God. The Lord is one. And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might. Would you stand with me, please, for prayer? You are a faithful God. And I can think back over my life at the promises you've made that you've kept in my life, the prayers you've answered. I can think back to the times that you brought me through trials and sorrows and hurts. You've never failed me. But God, it's not enough for me to know that. I need my children to know that. I need my grandchildren to know that. So, Father, I pray that as we make you the priority in our life, as we become more convinced and we know, we absolutely know that we can trust you, that we will be able to see our faith become our children's faith and our grandchildren's faith until the day comes when we reach that heavenly promised land and are perfectly satisfied. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.